Okay, so hello everybody. It's a pleasure to open our school on modular spaces, combinatorics, and integrable systems. I just want to draw your attention to the fact that this school is a part of a long-term program on modular spaces, combinatorics, and Poisson geometry, which will take place next year at the Euler International Mathematical Institute in St. Petersburg, somewhere from May to August. So everybody is welcome to follow the Institute website and to register for this program. Okay, and today we have our first speaker, Professor Nicolai Reshetikhin from Tsinghua University and University of California at Berkeley. He is a well-known mathematical physicist, and he actually doesn't need any introduction. So I just pass the word to him. Kole, your turn.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, it's thank you for organizing this school. It's a nice opportunity to visit St. Petersburg again. So I'll talk about superintegrable systems on modular spaces of flat connections over a surface. And here's the plan for the lectures. So first, today, I don't think I'll come to modular spaces. So I just want to focus on the phenomenon which is known as superintegrability in Hamiltonian dynamics. This can be considered as some kind of refinement of Liouville integrability. We will see the details very soon. So then during the second lecture, I'll introduce the kind of variety of superintegrable systems on modular spaces of flat G connections over surfaces. The third lecture and the fourth lecture will be examples, and I'll discuss some aspects of quantization of these integrable systems. Okay, so our topic for today is superintegrability, and so there are two other terms for this phenomenon. It's degenerate integrability and non-commutative integrability. The most kind of iconical example of such Hamiltonian system is the Kepler system, when you have in three-dimensional space gravitational center and your particle is moving in the Newtonian gravity force. So this, the study of such systems goes back to works of Fock and Pauli on the hydrogen atom, which is a quantum version of Kepler's system. So then Smoradinsky, Winternitz, and others, they came up with more examples. Nihoroshev, student of Arnold, he kind of developed a general theory. And then Mishenko and Fomenko, they provided a series of examples related to Lie algebras. And then there was a kind of steady development after this. So first, let me define this notion. So it's a notion in Hamiltonian dynamics. So first we fix the phase space of our system, a symplectic manifold. So then classical algebra of observables. Is the algebra of smooth functions on M. I mean, to be realistic, these are almost always analytic functions and almost always algebraic functions. So then the dynamics is fixed by Hamiltonian, which is the energy function on the phase space. And here is the definition. The Hamiltonian flow generated by H is superintegrable if there exists a Poisson subalgebra of rank 2n minus k. So what does it mean? It means that it has a maximal independent set of 2n minus k functions in it. And another name for this is Krull dimension of this algebra. It's in the algebraic case. So it's a Poisson subalgebra. So that's the first ingredient. And the second ingredient is the Poisson center of J, which is the collection of all elements which Poisson commute with any element in J. Just as there is a center of an associative algebra, there is a center of a Poisson algebra. So this center should have rank k. In other words, it should contain maximum k independent functions. And again, in algebraic terms, the Krull dimension of this commutative algebra should be k. So this is the algebraic definition of a superintegrable system. So you can see that if k is equal to n, that's the Liouville integrability. And if k is less, k cannot be bigger than m, otherwise we don't have Poisson commutative subalgebras of that rank. So the interesting case is when k is less than m. But if you look at this definition, you can see that these two most important ingredients, they don't require the choice of the Hamiltonian. So you can choose any Hamiltonian, any function from the center of this Poisson subalgebra J. And what is most important is that you have this structure. You have the Poisson subalgebra of rank 2n minus k in a Poisson algebra of rank 2n, and the center of this Poisson subalgebra has rank k. So the meaning of this Poisson subalgebra is the following. This is the algebra of Poisson commuting Hamiltonian. So this, it generates the action as in the Liouville case, it generates the action of a torus Hamiltonian action. The difference is that in the Liouville case, the dimension of this torus is n, and in this case, the dimension is less. So now in the Liouville case, there is no intermediate subalgebra. Now we have it, and this is the algebra of conserved quantities because our Hamiltonians are in the center of this Poisson algebra. Our Hamiltonians commute with everything in this algebra. So you can fix these integrals of motions and you will have the level surface, which will be the analog of the Liouville tori in this superintegrable case. So these are conserved quantities. The thing is that now they don't Poisson commute, but you know, if we just want to have integrals that don't change with the evolution, we don't care whether they Poisson commute or not. So this is the structure. This is what it means to have an integrable, to have a superintegrable system algebraic. And just one remark that J can be regarded as the centralizer of this commutative Poisson commutative subalgebra in A. In other words, it's the collection of all elements in A which Poisson commute with I. It just as an in the algebra, in the algebras, you have the notion of a centralizer of a subalgebra. The same is in Poisson algebras, because Poisson algebra, what is a combination of two structures, commutative algebra and the Lie algebra, which acts by derivations on the commutative structure. So everything that you have for Lie algebras, you have for Poisson algebras, every notion. So now I just want to say that in this setting, the centralizer is maximal possible. You cannot have a centralizer bigger than this for the commutative subalgebra of rank K. The maximum crude dimension of the centralizer is 2n minus k. Now, this is completely atypical because, say, if you just have some random function on a Poisson on your phase space, some random classical observable, nothing commutes with this function except for the function itself. So typically, centralizer has small dimension, and typically it's just a commutative algebra itself. But here we require that it's as large as possible. So in other words, we require that these dynamics, this commutative Poisson Hamiltonian flows, they have as many integrals as possible. Okay, so this is the algebraic definition of superintegrability, and geometrically, it means the following. And you can naturally reconstruct this picture from the algebraic one. So here you have a system of embedded Poisson subalgebras, which means that, say, in the algebraic case, if you pass to the spectrum of primitive ideals and these commutative subalgebras, so you have these projections of this algebraic variety. So in our smooth case, it just means that this is the geometric structure of the superintegrability. So what it is? It's two Poisson projections, P1 to a Poisson to a Poisson manifold of dimension 2n minus k, and the second one is P2 from this Poisson manifold to k-dimensional Poisson manifold with trivial Poisson structure. So how does it connect to the previous? Well, naturally, this functions on B is our Poisson commutative subalgebra of Hamiltonians. Maximal independent set in our subalgebra is just simply local coordinate system on B. Maximal independent set on J is just again local coordinate system on P. And the properties of this projection, which kind of is a translation of the properties of these subalgebras that I mentioned above, is that generic fiber of projection P2 should be 2n minus 2k dimensional symplectic leaf of our Poisson manifold P, and the generic fiber of projection P1 should be k-dimensional isotropic submanifold in M. Okay, so this is the setting. If you prefer geometric language, you use this one. If you prefer algebraic language, you use this one. If you prefer to go back and forth, you use both of these languages. So the theorem of Nikhorashev is the following. It's just a literal generalization adaptation of the Liouville theorem for this setting. So you pick up k independent functions from the subalgebra I. It just means that you choose some local coordinates on B. The Poisson commute, the Hamiltonian flows generate affine coordinates. Well, they generate some coordinates I, but if you change the coordinate system, if you change the collection of these independent integrals, you will have a coordinate transformation which will result in affine coordinate transformation, in other words, linear transformations and translations. And these phi are known as angle variables on, but now they are on level surfaces of conserved quantities of integrals. Okay, so these are our Liouville tori, and then in the neighborhood of such torus, you can write the symplectic form as the action angle part. Actions are coordinates on B, and angles are corresponding induced coordinates on level surfaces of J's. And but then this kind of Darboux part, it's only part of the symplectic form. The rest comes from the symplectic form on the corresponding symplectic leaf of P. So that's determined. By our Poisson manifold P. So each connected component of the so here it's P1 of the level surface. So this is level surface of integrals. That's of J's is isomorphic to the product of some Rn and some torus. That's just because it's because of the toric action, it's a topological fact, the same as for the Liouville integrability. And then just as in the Liouville case, flow lines of any Hamiltonian that belongs to the to this Poisson commuting subalgebra of Hamiltonians, flow lines are linear in angle coordinates. So if the level surface is compact, then you have this motion, kind of linear motion in this affine coordinate system on tori. If it's non-compact, it's just a straight line on a non-compact level surface. So this is this theorem, it kind of outlines the structure of superintegrable systems. So you can see that the difference with the Liouville integrability is that in this case, Liouville tori have less dimension than n, than half of the dimension of our symplectic manifold. So you may ask, what is the relation between superintegrability and Liouville integrability? The answer is the relation that's called refinement. So you may have a situation when a superintegrable system tells you more about the dynamics of a Liouville integrable system. So let's see, what do we have on the Liouville set? So if you have a Liouville integrable system, you only know that there are n-dimensional invariant Liouville tori. So you don't know whether the trajectories are periodic, whether they span the whole torus, or whether they span some sub-torus. This is the information that sort of is should be resolved separately. Just Liouville integrability doesn't say anything about this. However, if you have a superintegrable system, then you know that you have k-dimensional invariant tori. So these are the level surfaces of the subalgebra of integrals. But it may happen that you have two systems, say you have the Liouville integrable system and you have superintegrability, superintegrable system. And it may happen that integrals of your Liouville integrable system, it's a subalgebra, Poisson commuting subalgebra in the algebra of conserved quantities of a superintegrable system. In other words, you can have this sequence of embedded subalgebras such that this one is Poisson commuting. This one is also Poisson commuting. This one is not. So in this case, what can you say? In this case, you know that the invariant tori are k-dimensional. It means that you have more information about the Liouville integrable system. So this is it's natural to call this refinement. So you kind of refining the integrable dynamics of the Liouville integrable system. So here is an example. If you have a four-dimensional phase space and Liouville integrable system, you have two-dimensional Liouville tori, and they may be densely covered by flow lines of two Poisson commuting Hamiltonians, or possibly they have periodic Hamiltonians. If you have if you have a superintegrable system that is a refinement of this Liouville integrable system, then you know that all trajectories are periodic. So this is the case when the refinement exists. It may be that you have integrable systems where the trajectories are densely covering the tori. Then it's clear that the system is not superintegrable. So you may have this refinement, you may not have this refinement. In a superintegrable system, your tori, they may be organized in such a way that they are sub-tori of Liouville tori, just as in this example. Or maybe globally, they may look more complicated. So it's not guaranteed that any superintegrable system has a Liouville integrable counterpart. So it's a question about whether there is a Poisson commuting subalgebra of rank n in this Poisson subalgebra of rank 2n minus k. So I don't know. So this is a school. So any questions about this? I assume there are lots of students.
I have a question. Uh-huh. Where did the Liouville torus come from?
Oh, Liouville torus, this one?
Yeah, for example.
So you have, say you have four-dimensional phase space, you have two independent integrals, and then the Liouville torus, it's just, in this case, it's just level, it's a connected component of the level curve of the Hamiltonians. You fix the value, that's typically the structure of Liouville tori. Did I answer the question or?
Okay, and this x is not equal to zero.
Which x?
Can it be x small? Can it
no,
be?
This is the collection of all points in the manifold where integrals have this value.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Okay, let's look at the basic example that came from 300 years ago. So Kepler system. So our phase space, it's a Hamiltonian framework for the Kepler system. Our phase space is just R6, which is the cotangent bundle to R3, with standard coordinates P and Q, with standard symplectic form omega. So in terms of coordinates, Poisson brackets are just determined by this symplectic form, 0, Qi, Qj is 0. So what can we say about this dynamical system? So it's clearly rotationally invariant. So generators of rotation, the momenta, angular momenta, they Poisson commute with the Hamiltonian. That's the rotational invariance. But then there is a magic. There are so-called Lens vectors, which have long history, going through Liouville back to Kepler himself, and to, in particular, to the uncle of Euler, and I forgot his name. He was an astronomer in Basel, and he, I think, first formally introduced these vectors as we know them now in classical mechanics. So it turns out that they also commute with the Hamiltonian. And they have the following Poisson brackets. So naturally, this is the these are the Poisson generators of rotations. So it's a Lie algebra SL2. Momenta commute with the components of the Lens vector in this way. And components of the Lens vector, they commute with the between themselves in this way. And as I already mentioned, the Hamiltonian commutes with angular momenta and with the components of the Lens vector. So if we wouldn't have relations, we would have a disaster. We would have three M's, three A's, one Hamiltonian. So we would have seven kind of local coordinates on the six-dimensional manifold. So of course there should be relations, and it turns out that there are two relations. So they are written here. So what we have is, as a consequence of all this, what we have is the following. This is our algebra of classical observables A. So it's just, as usual in the textbook Hamiltonian mechanics, these are functions of P and Q. In this algebra, in this Poisson algebra, we have a Poisson subalgebra, J5. It's the quotient of this Poisson algebra by the relations that we have. So we have seven variables, two relations. So this Poisson algebra has rank 5. And inside, there is a subalgebra of functions of the Hamiltonian. So, and it's easy to check that this is exactly the center of our, so we have this Poisson subalgebra, and then we have the center of the of this Poisson subalgebra. Geometrically, it means that our six-dimensional phase space, which is T star R3, is fibered over five-dimensional Poisson manifold. And this five-dimensional Poisson manifold is fibered over a real line. So this is just these are just all possible values of the Hamiltonian. And because the rank of this, the dimension of this base of the fibration pi 2 is 1, so it means that all trajectories are periodic. All compact trajectories are periodic, non-compact trajectories are just straight lines. So this is called maximal superintegrability. So we have a maximal maximally superintegrable system. And if you're interested in Poisson geometry, when you see Poisson manifold, your first reaction should be, what is the set of symplectic leaves of this Poisson manifold? And what is the structure of these symplectic leaves? So that's a normal reaction of a Poisson geometer when he or she sees the Poisson manifold. It's the same as someone who works in representation theory would observe the associative algebra. In associative algebra, the first question would be, what is the set of irreducible representations of this associative algebra? All of same question about Lie algebras. Okay, so it turns out that in this case, symplectic leaves are the following. Well, symplectic leaves are fibers of this second projection P2. And remember that these are the fibers over the real line. These are all possible energies. In our system, in other words, these are the values of H. And clearly, since H has the positive part P squared and negative part minus gamma over the distance, just look at this function, you can see that it has values from minus to plus infinity. So this is this axis E. And then it's not difficult to check, and it's a wonderful exercise, just to see that if E is less than zero, and it's a Kepler system that everyone knows, but not everyone knows this structure on the Kepler system. So if E is less than zero, the symplectic leaves are just coadjoint orbits for SO4. So these are the just two spheres. If E is zero, the corresponding fiber is the cotangent bundle to a sphere, and that's a coadjoint orbit in the in the dual space to the Lie algebra of Euclidean motions, translations and rotations. And then if the energy is positive, then the corresponding fiber, the symplectic leaf of this Poisson manifold is a hyperboloid in the dual space to the Lorentz, to the Lie algebra of the Lorentz group. So this is so-called hidden Lorentz symmetry in the hydrogen atom, which is a quantum version of the Kepler system. Okay, so it's a maximally superintegrable system. But then if you have seen this integrable this system before, if you thought about this as an integrable system, you can see immediately that, say, if you will take z projection of the momentum and z projection of the length vector and the Hamiltonian, these three functions are independent. They are Poisson commuting, which means that we also have the Liouville integrability. And clearly, in this example, we have the refinement of the Liouville integrability by this superintegrability of the Kepler system. If we just have this information, we don't know whether trajectories are periodic, compact trajectories are periodic. So of course, when E is less than zero, we have compact trajectories. When E is from zero to plus infinity, they are non-compact. So we don't know whether they're kind of three-dimensional in tori or one-dimensional, but now we do. So that's how it works. So now, any questions about Kepler system?
I do have a question. Mm-hmm. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
So I was wondering, in SO4, there are degenerate leaves. I was wondering how, so the system, I imagine, avoids those leaves, right? Because of dimensional reasons. So I was wondering, like, how are these, so the energy below zero and the energy equal to zero, like globally patched together?
It's a good question. You know, I didn't ask myself this question. But in some sense, the answer is here. So this is the Poisson algebra, which is just the quotient of this Poisson algebra generated by angular momentum, length vectors, and the Hamiltonian by these relations. And these are just symplectic leaves of this algebra. So it's a good homework. Find how they fit together. I mean, the answer that I wrote here is just if E is strictly less than zero, you have one topological structure. If E is zero, you have the other topological structure. If E is strictly positive, you have the third one.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
That's just how it is. Other questions?
Can I ask you just a basic question? What do you mean by the dual of SO4?
You know, so when you have a finite dimensional algebra, G star is just the dual vector space. To G. And then there's a fundamental fact about this vector space is that it's a Poisson manifold.
Oh, so you consider a Lie Poisson structure on G star and you take the dual group.
Right.
Okay.
There's a Kirillov constant Poisson structure.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Okay, so you see, history is not always fair to good names. So there, as I mentioned at the beginning, superintegrable systems are mostly known as superintegrable systems. They are also known as degenerate integrable systems. They are also known as non-commutative integrable systems. So non-commutative integrable systems, well, the words are meaningful, at least a little bit, in the sense that these integrals, J, they don't Poisson commute. In this sense, non-commutative integrable systems would be somewhat meaningful term. Now I want to explain why degenerate integrability makes sense. But historically, the most optimistic and completely meaningless word term superintegrability, of course it won, just because it's super. So anyway, so let's not argue about it. It's an established terminology. But now, why was it called degenerate integrability at some point? So there is a very simple explanation if you go to the quantum mechanics. Let's just do it on the example of quantum Kepler system. Quantum Kepler system is just the hydrogen atom. So what is a quantization in this case? Well, you replace functions on the cotangent bundle to R3 by differential operators. And this is the quantum algebra of observables. And then you can think of functions on the cotangent bundle to R3 as symbols of these differential operators. So then there is a definition, I mean, there is a well-established notion of quantum angular momentum, quantum length vector, quantum Hamiltonian, which is simply minus Laplacian, minus the same Coulomb potential. And in the quantum case, you still have this structure. You have the algebra of differential operator on R3. In this algebra, you have the rank 5 subalgebra generated by this. Don't ask me what it means, rank 5. I can tell you what I mean by this, but it's not well established terminology notion in quantization, as far as I can see. So yes, so it's a subalgebra generated by components of momentum and components of the Lens vector and the Hamiltonian. So then its center is the subalgebra generated by the Hamiltonian. So by the way, a small remark, it's an associative algebra. So just as any Poisson geometer who looked at the corresponding five-dimensional Poisson manifold immediately asks the question, what are the symplectic leaves? So any representation theorist looking at this associative algebra should ask the question, what are the irreducible representations of this algebra? But you know, physicists, they don't care about representation theory unless it represents some symmetry of a system. So in the very first question physicists ask is, what is the spectrum of the system? So what is the spectrum of the Hamiltonian of the hydrogen atom? And the answer is well known. It's a union of a discrete spectrum, the level zero, and a positive spectrum. And the discrete spectrum has this structure. So it's parameterized by integers from one to infinity. And the dependence on the Planck constant is this, through the product n times h. What else is known about the spectrum? Well, if you want to know the spectrum, you should also, if you have a discrete spectrum, you should also describe the, at least the dimensions of the eigenspaces. So here it's well known, the dimension of the eigenspace is n squared. So it means that the corresponding eigenspace, well, if you know that it's n squared, then you know that it's probably natural to think about it as the tensor product of two n-dimensional spaces. So, and you know, if you have enough kind of fantasy, then you can think, okay, maybe there is some representation of SL2, or the SU2 is acting here. And indeed, we have the angular momentum. So it's SO3 in this case. It acts diagonally on this space. Diagonally simply means that X acting on V tensor W is XV tensor W plus V tensor XW. So with respect to the diagonal action of SO3, this tensor product, naturally, you know, as we all learn, you know, in the high school or in the first year of the university, it can be decomposed into the direct sum of irreducible subrepresentations. And in chemistry, these are known as orbitals. And, you know, it was always a mystery to me. What are the orbitals? Why are they so complicated? But then when you think about this superintegrability, it all makes sense. Because actually there are two algebras acting on these multiplicity spaces. There is this algebra J5 that acts irreducibly on this tensor product. And there is angular momentum, which is subalgebra of this algebra. It doesn't act irreducibly, the representation decomposes into irreducible components. And so that's the structure of the spectrum of the hydrogen atom. So if you don't know about this algebra, it's a little bit of a mystery. Why you should consider these spaces? Why not just to say that you have the eigenspace of dimension n squared, and by some mystical reasons, it's the direct sum of irreducibles for S of 5. But you see, but if you know this fact, then it's all very natural. There's this tensor product space, which is an irreducible module over this algebra, which describes the true symmetry of the system. And then part of this symmetry is the rotational symmetry. Okay, now it's about the symmetry and representation theory, but now let's look at the semi-classical limit. So in the semi-classical limit, we want to see what happens if h goes to zero. Well, I'm talking as a mathematician now, because physicists would never say that this Planck constant, which is constant, goes to zero. But we'll understand what it means. So h goes to zero, n goes to infinity. The product is fixed, so that we're looking at the limit when h goes to zero and the energy level is fixed. What happens to the dimensions of eigenspaces of E? We know that the dimension is n squared, so it behaves as h to the minus 2. And if you think about what 2 means in this case, 2 is half of the dimension of, so you remember, 2 is the dimension of S2 cross S2, that's the fiber over the negative energies. 2 is the dimension of T star S2 divided by 2, that's the fiber over zero energy. And 2 is the dimension of the fiber over positive energy. So it always 2, but we're interested in this. We are talking about negative energies. So this is half of the dimension of the symplectic leaf, corresponding symplectic leaf. So if you know what geometric quantization is, you immediately see that this is a typical asymptotic for spaces that are obtained by geometric quantization. And so conceptually, this is an illustration to a general feature, general kind of intuitive understanding of the difference between integrable and superintegrable system from the point of view of semi-classical asymptotics. When you have a Liouville integrable system, you quantize it, the dimension of the space of joint eigenspaces for all the for all quantum Hamiltonians is stable as h goes to zero. It's determined by some intersection numbers of some Lagrangian submanifolds, but it never grows like h to some power, to some negative power. In a superintegrable system, the dimension of joint eigensubspaces for all the quantum commuting Hamiltonians, it grows as h to the minus n minus k. In other words, it behaves as h to the minus half of the dimension of the corresponding symplectic manifold, corresponding symplectic leaf of this last projection, this symplectic leaf. So in this sense, the terminology degenerate is quite appropriate. It's just because when you're quantizing these systems, the spectrum is super degenerate. It's very degenerate. So this is the idea of superintegrability with one example I think I don't have any time left, right? Or do I still have 5 minutes?
Yeah, you have 5 minutes.
Okay. So before I'll start the last part, any questions about this example? Okay, so just, you know, we're slowly moving to moduli spaces. And as an intermediate object, so here's another example of superintegrable systems. These are so-called spin Kalogeri Moser systems. So here is the Hamiltonian of the spin Kalogeri Moser system for SUN. The phase space is this product. So this is where P and Q lives, and this is where the spin variables mu live. So how do we get this phase spaces? So it's just an ad hoc construction that I'm describing. Now, but it does have a lot to do with moduli spaces, as we will see. So you take the cotangent bundle to a Lie group. It's just a side remark that you can always trivialize it by left translations into the product. So if you quotient it with respect to the adjoint action of G, the result is a Poisson manifold, which has symplectic leaves. These symplectic leaves are obtained by, so this action is a Hamiltonian action. So there is a moment map. And these symplectic leaves are simply the result of the Hamiltonian reduction with respect to some coadjoint orbit of this T star G. So you can easily construct Poisson commuting Hamiltonians by taking the projection to the first component after the trivialization, say by left translations or by right translations, it doesn't matter. Hamiltonians are just simply pullbacks from this quotient space, or just pullback of the G invariant functions on G star. And then you have to restrict it to to our phase space. So after you do this, all this mantra, you discover that the Hamiltonians are given by a very simple formula. H is just a trace of X squared. All other Hamiltonians are traces of powers of X. And X is just this matrix. So there is a way how to describe the superintegrability. It's not very telling, but I'm just saying that it's an example. It's another example of a superintegrable system where you have in an obvious way less Hamiltonians than you would need for integrability. Say for any Lie algebra G, you have only rank of Poisson commuting Hamiltonians in the phase space that has the dimension of the coadjoint orbit, which is much bigger than the rank typically. So this is an example. As we will see, this example is related to the moduli spaces of flat connections when you have a torus with one puncture. And then there is a so-called two-spin Kalogeri-Moser-Sutherland system, so I think I'm running out of time. So I'll just describe the Hamiltonian of this system. I think for physicists, it has more appeal because by some mysterious reasons, if you will take the tensor, the Cartesian product of two coadjoint orbits of rank one, there is this isomorphism with the Hamiltonian reduction of n coadjoint orbits for SU2. In other words, n spheres. So in this case, you really have these are really physical SO3 spins. So that's the Hamiltonian of the two spin Kalogeri-Moser system for rank one orbits. And as we will see, it's related to moduli spaces of G bundles for a torus with two punctures. So I think this is where I have to stop today.
Okay, thank you, Kolya. Other questions or remarks?
So I see the question about whether there is more than one refinement of Liouville integrability. I think geometrically, not. I would say if you have Liouville tori, and if you know, for example, that they are fibered by one-dimensional tori, in other words, if you have maximal superintegrability, then you already have the description of these one-dimensional trajectories, which sort of fixes the dynamics. I think there is some kind of uniqueness there. But I don't know, I didn't think really about this.
There is one more question in chat.
Yes, I don't understand. Oh, Kalogeri. No, Kepler is different. No, these are three different superintegrable systems. The Kepler system, one spin Kalogeri-Moser and two spin Kalogeri-Moser.
Okay, if there are no other questions, then we make a break, 10-minute break till 6:15 Moscow time.